we're really getting close to the end of this conference. But before we get to the closing remarks, of course we would like to know a little bit more about what your opinion is on this conference. And there is an evaluation forum, but also, of course, on the content of this conference. There were some reporters in different working groups. Who was a reporter? I know Koen was one. Max Talon was one over there. Over here, there. Okay, start over there. So, in which working groups were you? May I ask you to stand up for a moment?
Yeah. I will speak in Spanish. Bueno, yo estaba en el grupo, en el taller número 4 del segundo día de hoy. Era el taller dedicado a el proceso de convertirse en un voluntario de Serclas aquí en Cataluña. Y bueno, se ha explicado, bueno, contábamos con parte del equipo de Serclas aquí. Estaba Ana Montes, que es la encargada de la gestión del voluntariado. Luego estaban dos coordinadores, Miguel y Rosa. Y después contábamos con tres voluntarios. Entonces, bueno, yo os voy a explicar un poquito lo que me ha parecido más relevante de la experiencia de los voluntarios, del testimonio que nos han dado. Porque como es más difícil oír su testimonio, pues vamos a aprovechar para hablar de ello. Lo que se ha destacado mucho es que los voluntarios son un agente sensibilizador con un gran potencial, porque con su experiencia, con el relato de su participación como voluntarios en esta intervención con los delincuentes sexuales, pues ellos tienen la capacidad de cambiar la percepción social poco a poco, de convencer de que es un colectivo con el que se tiene que intervenir y con el que precisamente es esto lo que hay que hacer para evitar víctimas, ¿no? Y un poco romper ese estigma tan fuerte, que es más fuerte que con otros colectivos, con otros tipos de delito. Después, bueno, los voluntarios han hablado de las dudas que tenían en el inicio de la participación en el programa, ¿no? En la primera formación, de las dudas que tenían acerca de si serían capaces de gestionar determinadas situaciones, de aportar algo, ¿no? Por esta ambivalencia respecto a las ganas de colaborar y de ayudar y de intervenir y sus propias opiniones, etcétera. Pero han explicado cómo a estas dudas pues ha respondido perfectamente la formación que les dieron los coordinadores, la comunicación constante que hay entre ellos, entre los propios voluntarios y con el coordinador, y que gracias a esto tienen seguridad. Y esta seguridad se refleja en que cuando no saben cómo afrontar una situación, pues siempre hay quien, ya sea otro voluntario o el propio coordinador, quien va a saber cómo continuar, cómo abordar las dificultades, etcétera.
Some more time? Or?
Yeah, as long as it fits what happens in the conference.
Okay.
Bueno, también se ha hablado de algunos principios que se transmitieron en las formaciones, que son básicos en este programa, que es el que no puede haber secretos en el círculo y de que esto no siempre es fácil de gestionar. Puede suponer algunas dificultades en algún momento, pero que esto al final siempre acaba fortaleciendo, o sea, las dificultades que puede haber siempre acaban fortaleciendo el propio círculo y la propia intervención. Y también otro tema que se ha tratado es el equilibrio que tiene que mantenerse siempre entre la información que comparten los voluntarios como parte de la intervención, porque una parte muy importante de la ayuda que ofrecen los voluntarios al miembro central es precisamente pues la del tiempo libre, ¿no? Cómo afrontar este tiempo libre que aparece de nuevo fuera de la prisión, y en esto es muy importante esta información que tienen los voluntarios como personas con diferentes estilos de vida, etcétera. Pero también hay el tema de la seguridad, ¿no? Pues hay un equilibrio que hay que mantener, hay la información que se comparte y la que no. Y bueno, en general lo que se ha destacado mucho es que es un voluntariado especial respecto a otros por el gran compromiso que que supone por el tiempo y la dedicación, etcétera, y bueno, que les ha que ha supuesto un gran aprendizaje para ellos y del bueno y que están convencidos de que tiene una gran utilidad social porque ven un impacto en, de su actividad y de su participación en el círculo en el miembro central.
Thank you very much. Thank you.
That's correct. I've been a reporter of the workshop one at the first day, yesterday, and today on workshop two. Okay.
Yeah. Thank you. Yeah. So maybe you can tell a little bit more about what happened in the workshop then. Let's start with the workshop yesterday.
Okay, it was a workshop on the selection of a core member, and it was a with three presentations of France, Latvia, and the Netherlands. So a country that has not implemented yet, but is thinking about implementation, a country that has implemented, but not so long ago, and a country that has a more established kind of COSA practice. And I thought it was very interesting to see that in France they were considering, well, what would be the criteria for the selection of a core member, and they kept quite close to the criteria as they are described in the European Handbook for Implementation, giving some specific considerations for the French context. And then came the presentation of Latvia, and Latvia I thought was very interesting because they presented mainly about the challenges for selecting a core member, and those challenges are coming from the practice. And there you see that, well, theory is nice, but practice, then it, mixing the theory with the practice, that becomes really interesting and really challenging. For instance, Imants, the presenter from Latvia, he told us that one challenge could be that the distance between the volunteers and the core member, maybe they live so far away from each other that it's, well, virtually impossible to match the two. Well, a country where that is not very likely to happen is the Netherlands, because it's smaller than Latvia and it has lots more inhabitants. The presentation of the Netherlands, I thought, was also very interesting because you saw, well, that challenges can be overcome, but also there you see that practice can have its influence on the way of thinking of COSA, because at the end, it was asked, well, how long do you think can a COSA circle last, or should it last? And well, France said, well, 1 year. Latvia said, well, yes, for us the same, 1 year. And then the Netherlands said, well, yes, we started thinking that it was 1 year, and then we thought, well, sometimes it's more beneficial to continue it, to stretch it up a little bit to 1.5 year. Now we're thinking, well, maybe 2 years, but well, if everything everyone sees the benefits of it, then should there really be a maximum? So I thought, yes, that's also the influence of practice. So that's why I really liked the workshop, because it gave, well, such a rich overview.
Yeah, and also it stresses the importance also of a network, that you can exchange these sort of information, theory, practice, new insights. So that's interesting, yeah. And the group for today, which one, it was group number two, wasn't it?
Yes, it was on media and media approach. And it was two presentations, one from Ireland, one from the UK. Ireland, as a country that is implementing, was sketching the situation in Ireland, the context in Ireland, and you could, in my words, mainly the concerns that you would have in managing the press. From the UK came the practice, and there it was very much stressed that press not only raises concerns, but also offers lots of opportunities, and how you can seize these. Title of the presentation is reference to the Trojan horse. Watch the Greeks when they bring gifts. I mean, the title in English is a little bit nicer than I recall. But well, at the end of the presentation, one of the presenters made a remark. Well, but the other way around is also true. I mean, Kosa can also be a Trojan horse in journalism, and well, that would be a surprise.
Whose responsibility is it to think of a communication strategy? Because that's also, of course, you can understand that it's necessary, but in the end, if you have volunteers, you have core members, you have professionals around it, and if everyone is responsible, no one is responsible.
Mm-hmm. Well, if the organization has a press department or a media department, that would work well because they're specialists. And if the organization has no media department, then it would be very beneficial to seek advice from people who are in the knowing. For instance, Circles UK, they have a journalist that is in their board of trustees, and well, it's a very good reference or advice for Circles UK.
Thank you very much. Thank you. Conchui, thank you. Mr. Max Salon, you were also reported in different working groups. Yeah.
Not only, only yesterday in workshop to organization and legal issues. And it was about, we had initially a general frame about the matter, and then we see three case studies, one about Belgium, the second one about UK, and the last one about Belgium. And the general framework was about to reflect on the underpinning matters that we may consider when we think about in which time the COSA scheme came. And we have two first ideas. The first one is that we are in a moment that there is the emergence of the new public governance paradigm, which includes the mix of public and private, and which includes the idea that transforming the pure public into a partnership with private sector, thinking that public safety is shared responsibility. So we may talk about co-creation instead of coordination. And the second one was about at the local level, we may take into consideration the particular historical, legal, and the background of the country and the local environment where we are applying the whole scheme. Then we look into the three study cases. First we started with Belgium, then we moved to UK, and finally we moved to the Netherlands. And the main conclusion from Belgium is for many reasons, this is a very complex country in terms of politics and judicial law. And they started just with one region, and with only the commitment of the probation service. And the main conclusion is that it's better to start in a whole scale at the whole country, not only in one region, and to have the engagement of all the agencies involved, not only probation, but also the federal government. And fortunately, in September 2014, they started to a second scheme in Brussels, which means that the project is going quite well. Then we move it into UK. UK is the most ancient scheme in Europe, and we learned a lot about an important thing was that COSA arrived at the exact moment, because the increasing attention from media, from public, from all organizations about the risk assessment, the risk, how to manage the risk, and COSA arrived just in the right moment for balancing this idea of risk and offering not only the control of the risk, but also to offering something to offenders that are taking part in this project. So in a way, it was a balance among the R&R schemes and also the systems and the good life model. And we went into how to manage the growing of the system and how to be able to jump from charities, volunteer sector to a more public sector, and finally to a more private sector in which consortiums play a big role in the whole scheme. And then we move into the Netherlands, and the Netherlands offer very good and very solid scheme about the implication of the three probation organizations, but also police, but also the central government, and we saw another way to organize this in a very, very wise model. The final recommendations, the final conclusions, you need three aspects, or you need three elements to be sure that you may succeed. Funding, good organization, and a solid and consistent support from the political and the institutional government or institution that is beside the project.
Thank you very much. Yeah, very clear. Thank you. Yeah. Maybe there are more reports, but this will be the final report, because I think there are also some of the main conclusions we will put also on the site, on the website, so it's just have a sort of basic view of what happens in all the different working groups. Which working group were you in?
I was in number one today, and that was with Elizabeth Hayes and Imance on new trends in treatment and integration of COZEN treatment. So I will just give a quick run through. Elizabeth started with new trends in sex offender treatment, beginning with new models of change in offenders, and then changes in the methods and content of treatment. So I'll just give some highlights. Looking at sort of the risk needs responsivity model, Elizabeth talked about how, I suppose what I found really interesting was that there's a move away from looking at necessarily treating low-risk offenders, because the possibility for change, there may be change, there may be no change, or actually there's the possibility of a negative impact, so there's less of a focus on working with low-risk offenders, if I understood correctly. Then Elizabeth took us through some of the needs in relation to that, that part of the model, and I suppose which are now more focused upon in treatment, for example, offence supportive attitudes and intimacy deficits, and less on those that are shown not to have so much of an impact, including denial and lack of victim empathy. And in terms of response, I know, interesting, huh? In terms of responsivity, Elizabeth really talked about the need to tailor towards the characteristics of offenders, and I suppose what different characteristics really shape their ability to respond, including intelligence, but also psychopathy and denial as factors that shape treatment. Then we had a look at the Good Lives model. moving on, well, and also I suppose that it's a positive, it's looking at the positive psychology and not the negative psychology, possibility of change, I suppose. And also that in terms of self-identity for offenders going through treatment, but that those who can achieve a sort of a self-identity of redemption are much less likely to re-offend than those who focus more on condemnation. So it's that difference is important. And then changes in method and content, moving towards a more collaborative form of treatment, working with the offender as to what treatments might be most useful, and really tailoring them towards them. And also about the importance of who is delivering these treatments, and really for the need to have, I suppose, an awareness of the right staff and the right attitudes within those staff. Changes that I suppose are becoming to be more evidence-based now. And finally, moving on to Imance. wrong way. Imance talked about the unique context of Latvia and whether, I suppose, the integration of COSA in treatment. And Latvia being a unique context because COSA is integrated within public services. Now, they also had very early exposure to, in terms of their implementing of COSA, had very early exposure to the Canadian model of implementation. So I suppose the two are integrated there, but I think Imance focused rather on them being necessarily integrated. He was saying it's more that they are delivered in parallel and that they're complementary, but also quite different. So the COSA is not an extension of treatment, it coexists and contributes to it. And then he ended with a really nice sort of picture of he suggested that actually Koza and Offender Management dance together, and he had a picture of Beauty and the Beast dancing, and we.
Which one was the Beauty and which one the Beast?
I was going to say Iman thought, and I agreed with him, that Koza is the Beauty in that partnership, and then yes, so it contributes to treatment but is separate from it, and then we had a question from someone in the audience about. Do they need to be separate? And then there was a discussion about how they manage this within the Latvian context because the people work together and they have to have confidentiality agreements so that teams aren't sharing things that are confidential to their part of work. And then... Yes, sorry.
These were only the highlights, isn't it? Yeah.
I know, yeah. It was great. It was really good. Yes, the final one, Audrey talked about how in terms of information sharing around risk, actually that can be managed by the circle making the core member share that information with the other bodies. Yeah, and that's it.
Thank you very much. Thank you. Yeah. Before we go to the closing remarks for this conference, yesterday morning we started with talking to each other about the suggestions. Oh, you have also a report, Sil? Yeah, for sure. You may also, if you have a report, then you have a report. Yeah, especially if it's typed out. Yeah.
No, I will read it in Castellano. It is. I'm sorry. Voy a hablar del taller 4 del primer día sobre la adaptación de los círculos en Cataluña. En primer lugar, se explicó cómo surgió la idea de llevar a cabo este proyecto aquí. El modelo del programa Círculo se conoció a raíz de una investigación sobre delincuencia sexual y reincidencia que llevaron a cabo profesionales del Centro Penitenciario Abierto 1 de Barcelona. En ese momento ellos desconocían la existencia de los círculos, pero al ver a través del trabajo de investigación el alto índice de éxito de este tipo de programas, pensaron en la posibilidad de llevarlo a cabo en Cataluña. Se consideró, en primer lugar, que Cataluña reunía los parámetros que eran necesarios para desarrollar una experiencia de estas características. Se visitaron diversas experiencias en Inglaterra y en Holanda, y posteriormente colegas de Circles UK se hicieron cargo de la formación de nuestros profesionales en Cataluña. Se organizó un focus group para estudiar el proyecto y su viabilidad junto con jueces, personal de los servicios de salud, universidad y profesionales de los servicios sociales penitenciarios. En segundo lugar, se habló de los criterios de selección de los miembros centrales y los instrumentos diagnósticos para la evaluación. Del conjunto de delincuentes sexuales, el grupo Diana, sobre el que se centró el proyecto, fueron los delincuentes sexuales con un riesgo alto y medio de reincidencia violenta. Esto supone el 30% del conjunto de los delincuentes sexuales en las prisiones de Cataluña. Habían de estar en régimen de semilibertad o en libertad condicional. Deberían haber reconocido el delito y deberían participar de manera voluntaria. A partir de las propuestas que llegaron de los diversos centros penitenciarios, se evaluaron 16 casos, se seleccionaron 5 y finalmente se iniciaron 3 círculos. Finalmente hablamos de la influencia del círculo para el miembro central. Y los temas que surgieron fueron que el objetivo era mejorar la percepción de uno mismo y esto se consigue inicialmente partiendo de un relato autobiográfico en el que el miembro central debe reflexionar sobre quién era en el momento de la comisión del delito, quién es en la actualidad y quién quiere ser en el futuro. El círculo no solo es estático y basado en el diálogo dentro del círculo, sino que además incluye compartir actividades de tipo cultural, de voluntariado y participando en actividades a nivel de barrio, etcétera, con acompañamiento. A lo largo del proceso se han observado mejoras en la actitud del miembro central, más ganas de salir a la calle, una mayor motivación para el cambio, una mejora en la autoestima y en la gestión de las emociones. Finalmente, hubo debate, hubo bastantes preguntas. Una de ellas hacía referencia al efecto negativo que podría tener una reincidencia cometida por un miembro central durante el desarrollo de un círculo, fundamentalmente por la alarma social que ello puede generar y por el riesgo que puede suponer para la supervivencia misma del programa. Esto requiere que el círculo sea mucho más consciente de su función de supervisión, de los factores dinámicos de riesgo con los que los miembros centrales fueron diagnosticados en el momento de su ingreso en el círculo. Otra cuestión planteada ha sido la posibilidad de que el modelo de círculo se pueda aplicar a personas que han cometido otro tipo de delitos, como por ejemplo en casos de delitos violentos. Se ha planteado si la comunidad ha aceptado positivamente el programa y la respuesta es que la prueba de que ha habido una muy buena respuesta es que la captación de voluntarios fue todo un éxito.
Thank you very much. Thank you. You all visit all the workshops anyhow, so by listening in the highlights. What I was trying to start with was the sort of final remarks, because at the beginning yesterday I asked you to just talk to your neighbor about your expectations of this conference. So for the last time, this time, during this conference, I would like to ask you to talk to your neighbor for 2 minutes about what you think of this conference. What are your insights? Maybe questions to open some, maybe we didn't fit your expectations on some points and we would like to hear as well. So your neighbor is still sitting next to you for 2 minutes. Two, one. Okay, let's see what happens. Always look at who's talking the longest. There's over there, is a discussion. Yeah, over there. Yeah. Oh, you're still talking. I go over here. Yeah. What were you discussing about?
In the Spanish.
Yes, please. And then I take your
Bueno, tanto yo, Jesús del Rey, como Laura Negredo, venimos en representación de la Secretaría General de Instituciones Penitenciarias y veníamos con un objetivo muy concreto, cuál es recabar información y establecer contactos de cara a la posibilidad de implantar el modelo de círculos en la Administración General del Estado, ¿no? Entonces, desde ese punto de vista, la verdad es que nuestras expectativas se han cumplido con creces porque hemos recabado muchísima información. También tenemos que decir que cuanta más información tenemos, más dudas tenemos, lo cual es bueno por otra parte, ¿no? Y por otra parte también, pues hemos conocido, a viejos conocidos, los hemos vuelto a saludar, hemos conocido a gente nueva y también de otros países. Y creemos que tenemos material suficiente como para presentar a los responsables de instituciones penitenciarias una propuesta de implantación del modelo y ya a esperar a ver qué decisión se toma.
Thank you very much. Let's see. May I ask over here? What did you talk about in this 1 minute? Oops, yeah.
Bueno, no, simplemente pues una... Perdón. una buena valoración de todo el Congreso, porque hemos podido ver tanto a la implantación que se está llevando a cabo aquí ahora mismo, con todas las dudas que puedan surgir, pero también pues cómo se está llevando a cabo a lo largo en toda Europa, desde iniciativas mucho más consolidadas en Holanda, en Reino Unido, pero también pues en los países que como nosotros, como aquí en Cataluña, o como a lo mejor puedan hacer en el resto de España, están intentando pues sacar la cabeza para intentar implementarlo. Y muy interesante, simplemente.
Thank you very much. Thank you. Yeah. Yesterday evening we were at the same dinner table and you were mentioning that in 2 weeks' time the circle starts in your prison, isn't it? So did you have any new insights? Because then you can use it within 2 weeks. So it's, may I ask?
Yeah, I mean, what was reassuring is that the things that we learned, the way that we're planning on implementing the circle is very much the way that the established circles are working. So it's very reassuring to know that we're on the right tracks, and I'm picking up one or two points that we can use. I think the only thing that I'd like to say, I think it was absolutely brilliant. It was great to network with everybody, to meet people from other countries. The only two things I would like to see in a conference going forward is I'd like some address for female sex offenders, which we haven't referenced, and I'd also like to remember, I think most, we have referenced it, but largely a lot of the references have been to do with paedophiles, and I think we should also remember that sex offenders can be rapists and so on as well. So, yeah.
Thank you very much. Thank you. Yeah. Did you sell any devices from Switzerland? Because you were mentioning yesterday morning that you also came here in the hope that some people came up to you in the coffee breaks.
Yeah, actually, the goal was not directly selling the devices as such, but seeing what kind of possibilities we have. And my observation here is, first of all, I understand much more what COSA is about. And the second thing is, I get the impression that right now in many places you have the sex offender who stays in prison until like the last day, and then he gets a full release. And I'm very, how do I say that? Relieved to see that the COSA starts actually before the release, and it's not like the offender gets out and then he's looking around, what should I do, and then somebody comes and says, hey, I can maybe help you. But it starts half a year before, and personally I think a possibility might be that the offender gets an early conditional release, like a smaller step. It's a smaller step for him, it's a smaller step for society as well. And of course COSA should follow the person, and personally I also think that in a conditional release, if there is a follow-up or a monitoring of the person with an electronic device, there would be a possibility to integrate COSA in this process. For instance, the device can detect an anomalous behavior, and instead of immediately sending the police, there might be a possibility to get the COSA members first to say, look, this is not a highly risk violation of the rules. Maybe you should go and talk to him and see what's happening instead of, yeah. So I think that would be a possibility, and if anybody's interested, let me...
They can still come up to you. Yeah, clear. Okay. Wonderful. Yeah. Okay. Now, the best way, of course, to find out what you think of this conference is just to fill in the evaluation form. There's in your in the brochure, there's also this evaluation form, and I think you can give it at the same desk where you can have give back also the translation device, so to get back your ID card so you can get in the plane. Then you have a card to get into this building, the museum card, and it's you can use it for the whole day. So for sure, you saw all the children running around, and that's because it's, I think it's really a great museum. So you can do all sorts of stuff, and it's very nice and very interesting to look around. So, and I think it's open for the whole afternoon, and you can just stroll around during this afternoon. Then it's important for the partners of Circles for EU that you're, after closing this conference, you have to go to the canteen, isn't it, for an extra conference. So we're going just to the other conference. So that was it, I think, for now. And then we're going to the closure of this conference. May I have a very warm applause, and I'm going to ask him to sit behind the desk, Mr. Soler, Mr. Seron, and Mr. Vogelvang.